Hi, welcome to Cloud Cover. My name's Nick Harris, and today I'm joined by...
Chris Rasner.
And...
Brady Gaster.
So Brady, it's been probably forever since you've ever been on our show, but you used to host Webcamps TV.
Yep.
And at one point in time there, you were actually one of our teammates as well. So tell everyone what's happening in Brady Land at the moment.
In Brady Land. Well, my son has strep throat.
Okay.
Not that part of Brady Land.
Exactly. Yeah. I have switched over to the Azure engineering team. Mm-hmm. Specifically, I'm a program manager on the Azure SDK.
Okay.
So what we do is we kind of, Jeff Wilcox put it really well one day. He said, we don't write all the SDKs. We would never get anything done. We just work with all the teams that are writing the SDKs to kind of make sure that they're kind of synonymous with one another. And what we've been working on recently, which I'm going to talk about today, is the Windows Azure management libraries. So we're going to talk about that a little bit today, and that'll make your the management of your Azure assets easier, as you'll see soon.
Okay, cool.
So it's been fun, though.
Yeah, nice.
I miss you guys.
We miss you, too.
I miss the studio.
Most of the time.
Exactly.
So, but before we jump into the Windows Azure Management Libraries, which are newly just released at the same time the show is published.
In preview.
In preview. So I guess you can give us all the specifics and disclaimers about that.
Yep.
Because it's something you've worked on, so it's probably got a whole bunch of disclaimers,
exactly.
Right?
Yeah.
Sometimes
but
it works.
What's that term we came up with in Australia? I was progastinating?
Yeah, progastinating.
So,
before that, let's do the usual. Let's check out what's new this week.
Fantastic. So only a couple things in news this week. The first thing is for Azure Mobile Services, there are a number of different quick starts you can use to kind of get a templated application to see how mobile services work. And, you know, they're right there on the portal, and there's a Windows Store, Windows Phone 8, an Android, an iOS, and an HTML JavaScript quick start. You know, you just pick the platform, and you can download this app. One of the things that's missing, though, is an example of how to do this from WPF. Well, in this blog post from Carlos, he's going to walk you through creating a WPF app and then basically doing the same sort of application that you get from the quick start. So that's simple to do us. But here, we're going to do it in WPF.
Yep.
So you can walk through all this and see the code and, you know, just exactly what you need to do. And then down at the bottom, there's also a link to the completed code in MSDN. So if you want to see the kind of finished product, you can just go ahead and download that and walk through it yourself.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah. The second piece is another post from Vittorio about Windows Azure AD. This time he's talking about multi-resource refresh tokens.
Okay.
And basically what that is if you have like two web resources, let's say you've got two web API services, and they've both been set up with my Windows Azure Active Directory tenant for security.
Yep.
If you authenticate with one of those, and it returns, instead of just normal resource token, it returns one of these multi-resource refresh tokens, then when your client application needs to access the other web service, you can, behind the scenes, use that MMRT token to just say, hey, give me a token for web service 2. So instead of having to basically prompt your user to authenticate again, you can behind the scenes kind of handle that for them.
Okay.
So just make it a little bit easier when your client applications are going from maybe one resource to another, all under the same Active Directory tenant.
Clean user experience.
Exactly. It's all about making it easier for the users.
Okay. Cool.
And that's what we've got today for the news.
Okay. So I guess we'll cut over to Brady. So let's do that, and we'll be back in a second. And we're back.
Nice.
Brady, what have you got?
What I've got right here is a web browser opened up, and it is on a nice, empty Windows Azure subscription. In a second, we're going to run some code using the Windows Azure Management Libraries to actually put some stuff out here. So I do want to show you, this is my MSDN account. It's completely empty with the exception of my Active Directory directory, which everybody gets by default. So I've already got that guy in there. But before I do that, I kind of want to show you the lay of the land when it comes to the Windows Azure Management Libraries. So what I've got here is a couple of slides, real brief slides, just to kind of show you kind of an idea of what we're talking about. Down at the bottom, we kind of have a common or core. We're calling it common because most of the stuff in common is going to be common to all the other satellite assemblies. down at the bottom of this common assembly, you see that I've got a flag off to the side that says it's base PCL. Mm-hmm. The nice thing about that is this common DLL that we're going to give you, you would be able to use this from, you know, a desktop application or a modern UI app, mm-hmm. Windows 8 app. Obviously, since it's going to be PCL, eventually we're going to have support for Windows Phone as well.
Okay.
So a lot of the stuff that you're going to see me do today, you can imagine being able to do this from anywhere that supports a PCL.
Right.
With the first preview release that we've got, we won't have support for Windows Phone, but it is coming pretty quick.
Okay.
We are definitely working on that. There's just a couple tweaks that we have to make to the mm-hmm. runtime wrapper, and then we're good to go. What you'll see here is that we kind of have the topology of the namespaces is pretty much Microsoft.Windows Azure. Dot management, hosted services, or compute. I think we've changed that to compute. Some of these might be out of date, forgive me. We've also got management.storage. Things change fast, they do. Management.websites, management.resource type, service bus, SQL, you know, you name it. Pretty much anything you can do in Azure using the portal, you'd be able to do using the management libraries.
Right.
I'm gonna go ahead and scroll on ahead here. We are gonna be putting these out as NuGets. So let's say you are like me, and most of the stuff that you do with websites. You would actually ask for, you'd say install package, you know, Microsoft.WindowsAzure.Management.Websites. And what that's going to give you is going to be the website assembly and then the one dependency. The nice thing about this, if I go back to this slide, you'll see that none of those satellite assemblies have interdependencies on one another. They only have a dependency on Common, and Common only has a dependency on BCL, mm-hmm. BCL build, HTTP client, and all that good stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So what we do is we pull down the Common, and we pull down the websites or whatever you've asked for, and you can start partying. Just, you know, spin up websites, create new websites, delete websites, start, stop, whatever you want to do. We don't have DNS management in there yet. That's one that I'd like to add eventually. But, you know, one day we'll totally get there.
It is in preview.
It is in preview.
Okay.
Right. So what we're doing is we're trying to evolve this SDK mm-hmm. as rapidly as the different partners evolve their APIs.
Mm-hmm.
So as you know, Windows Azure is just a big ball of REST APIs.
Mm-hmm.
We're wrapping all those REST APIs in this management library mm-hmm. set. So there's really just REST wrappers. It's not really a convenience wrapper, but we encourage you to write your own convenience wrapper to wrap all this stuff up if you want to. A little fluent interface, whatever you want to do. This is really just your SDK core.
Mm-hmm.
If I scroll ahead, now we're not calling it all. You'll see here that I've got install package, Microsoft.WindowsAzure.Management.all. That was a placeholder. I think we might actually call that libraries. It's kind of the name we're spinning mm-hmm. on right now. If you were to do that, that's going to bring down all the guys that you want. That's going to bring down website, storage, SQL, compute, the mm-hmm. whole world.
I like all.
Yeah, I like all. I think
it's very all-encompassing.
Yeah.
It is. We were joking about calling it Uber for a little while, which I know Nathan would like because he's always using Uber to get around. So there's that. Speaking of which, did you have fun at his wedding? Was that a good time?
Yes. Nate has married everybody.
Congratulations, Nathan.
Maybe we'll put up a static picture or something like that, maybe.
Good.
We might have to ask for permission for that.
That's good. So this is just kind of what we're thinking about doing, and we're going to give you the ability to just pull down one at a time or pull down everything if you mm-hmm. want it, so you'll be able to, you know, grab and go. All right, all that being said, how does it work? So that's what I'm going to show you now, and I've got a couple quick little demos that I want to show you real quick.
Mm-hmm.
I've got just a couple little files in here. I want to walk through these files. So I've got a program file here. This is really just a console app. It's just going to spin up and do some work for us. But what I've also got here is this scenario.cs file. This is kind of where all the code lives that's actually going to access the management libraries. So if I open this guy up real quick, I've zoomed my font excessively. So what I want to do is I'm going to scroll down here, and I'm going to show you that we have a couple of different methods in here. And this, again, is just my scenario class. You can imagine this would be mm-hmm. the code that you write. What I've done is I'm going to get the management client, which is going to give us the ability to do things like get all the locations in Windows Azure, manager, subscriptions, blah, 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 all that good stuff.
Right.
I've also got compute management client, which is going to give us the ability to do things with like hosted services, VMs, all that good stuff. And then I've also got the storage management client, which is obviously going to give you the ability to create and delete and, mm-hmm. you know, CRUD, you know, storage accounts.
Yep.
So this really just gives you the ability to programmatically do everything that you need to do up in Windows Azure. Mm-hmm. Pretty much like I said, if you can do it in the portal, you can imagine being able to do it in here.
Okay. In some cases, maybe more than what you can do in the portal. Features that the portal doesn't support yet, but are available within the API.
Right, because sometimes the APIs will go out before the portal skins will go out. So this would give, let's take cloud services, for instance. Let's say cloud services, they're going to rev their API.
Mm-hmm.
They could actually rev their SDK and publish it independently. That's why we didn't want to have all the interdependencies on one another. That way, each partner team can go at their own pace.
Yep.
So they can push out their NuGet and you can party on it. So as soon as they upgrade their as soon as they upgrade their API, they can just rev their SDK and they're good to go.
Okay.
And what I'll show you real quickly here is we've given you the ability. Let me put this out a little bit. So I've got this console tracing interceptor class right here. Mm-hmm. And what I want to do real quickly is just kind of open up this guy. And you'll see that it implements a specific interface, iCloud tracing interceptor. If I move my mouse over that, you'll see that it does indeed live inside of the management libraries.
Mm-hmm.
This is an interface that we give you so that if you want to trace the conversations going back and forth to the API and kind of see what's going on, you can write your own tracing interceptor. In this case, I'm just going to spit it out to the console log.
Okay.
You can imagine you've got a Windows app, you might have a text box on it, you just want to have a running log of everything.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
This gives you the ability to just hook in.
And see what's going on.
And just see what's going on. So you see that we've got information, configuration, that'll read the config from the portal. Enter, that actually enters the method, send request, that's mm-hmm. going to fire whenever we actually issue the HTTP request, you know, get the response back, yada yada. So you could just, you know, party on this and log everything out. And then what I'm doing here is I'm newing up my individual storage accounts, and what I want to do real quick is open up this method right here, subscription cloud credentials, get credentials. Now what you'll see is that I'm actually opening up a certificate file that I've got right here in my solution.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm passing it a subscription ID, which is my, you know, MSDN subscription ID.
So this is a cert you've already uploaded to Windows Azure.
So this is a cert that
management
I've uploaded.
Cert.
Yeah, this is a management cert that I've just put in there. We're actually going to give you, it's funny that you mentioned the AD stuff, in the PowerShell commandlets, we're actually going to be giving you the ability to authenticate using AD.
Mm-hmm.
So you'll have the ability to authenticate using a cert, and you'll have the ability to authenticate using AD. I don't know if the AD is going to be like all the way across every single individual, you know, asset type, but anything that supports it, we're going to be able to give you that that ability. Nice thing about that is we're going to roll all this up for you, so you could just, you know, hot swap in your authentication provider and you can party on it. Whenever we implement OAuth 2 years from now, you'll be able to use that too. So just something to think about. All right. So what I want to do now is I'm going to shrink this guy down and I'm going to show you what the language looks like inside of this guy. So right here, I've got a get locations method, and you'll see here that I've got management client.locations.list. So if I go up here and I just type management client, let me just copy that, so I don't have to type it all out, make too many errors, and I'll say locations, or I could say subscriptions. So you'll see here what we're doing is we're just hanging off an individual operation type from that client object. If I were to go over here and say storage management client, and say dot, I could do storage accounts, see there?
Yep.
And I can do delete or create or list, or I could get one. So that's my ability to basically CRUD up against Windows Azure using these libraries. So that gives you the ability to kind of do everything you'd need to do. So what I'll do here is I'm just going to put a breakpoint on this guy, and I'm going to go over here to my program file, which is where I'm actually calling the scenario code. And you'll see that I've got my subscription ID right here, and I just pass it in, and then I open up the cert, and I can party. And what I'm doing is I'm giving it a storage account name and a cloud service. And the first thing that I'm going to do, I'm going to put a return block right here, because I don't want to run the code below here. And I'm just going to call the get locations method. That's going to go into here. I'm going to reach out to the API, say, give me all the different regions that I support in Windows Azure, and then I'm just going to look at them in the debugger. So right now, I'll just hit F5. It's actually going to go out, hit my portal. Hit my Windows Azure subscription, hit F10 here, and you'll see that the tracing is already lighting up. So we've kind of turned it light gray so you can kind of see, and this is everything that we are communicating with back and forth to the server, all the stuff that we're passing it. I'm just going to go ahead and move my mouse over this result real quick and expand it, and I'll open up the results view, and you'll see that we're actually objectifying everything. So in each individual location, that's actually a different object, and there's the name, East Asia. And if I open up available services, that'll show us everything that you can do in that particular region. So that's just a, you know, pretty simple test call to make sure that I'm authenticating properly back and forth. It's kind of a, you know, silly little test just to make sure we're all dialed in. Now I'm going to do something a little bit more complicated. I'm going to go ahead and turn off this return. You'll see that I've got this upload package to blob. I'm going to hit F12 here. And I do want to point out that one of the things that I'm doing is I'm actually referencing the storage SDK in this, because I'm actually going to create a storage account, then I'm going to use the storage SDK to actually use that storage account and publish a blob to it. So first thing I need to do is probably create that storage account. account. So I'm going to put that method call right there. And you'll see that I've just made a little fluent guy here. This is an example of you creating your own convenience wrapper to wrap mm-hmm. around the management library calls.
Okay.
So what I'll do now, I'm just going to go into this guy real quick. I'm going to put a breakpoint right here. And then I'm actually going to go and put a breakpoint right here as well. Before I run this code, I want to point out again, I've got this storage management client property. I can do storage accounts.create, and I can pass it, you know, all the different parameters I need to pass it, like I'm doing right down here, passing it the name of my storage account and a label. And I'm actually going to tell it which location I want it to be in. And one of the things that we've done in the libraries is made it really easy for you to figure out certain things when it comes to, mm-hmm. you know, static variables for all intents and purposes. Mm-hmm. West US, you don't want to have to remember that string, and if we ever change it, you know, it'd be nice to have a system of record that you get that list from, and then you can make use of it. So we're just giving you an enum here. Then what I'm going to do, see here that I've got storage accounts again, and I'm going to type get keys.
Right.
And I'm actually going to pass it the name of the storage account, and that's going to hand me back the primary key.
Right.
So that's actually what I'm going to use with my storage account name and that key to actually build my connection string right here. I just build that guy up. And then down below, I'm going to actually use the normal storage SDK to upload a CS package file. Now what you'll see right here, I'm going to upload this CS package file. It lives right here in my sample service, and I've also got a CSCFG file, which is my XML config.
So this is just like a web or worker role.
That's exactly what it is.
Pre-packaged.
Yep. Okay. It's like I'd created a new cloud project, added a web role to it, compiled it, built it, then I took the CS package file and dragged it into here.
Yep.
So I can do whatever I want. And the reason we give you this ability is we want to give you the ability to create. I'm going to go ahead and run this, so we'll go ahead and get this started. We want to give you the ability to create a storage account and then put your CS package file into it from which you can then deploy your hosted service. So I'll hit F10 right here, and that'll take a second to run because it actually has to go out, create the storage account, resolve DNS, and all that.
Can we see the storage account created in the portal as
part
of this?
Yes, you will. Once this this call gets finished creating, you'll actually see it light up. Let me hit F5 and see if it's spinning, saying that it's resolving DNS.
Okay.
So there it is. So there's my cloud cover storage account that I just created.
Excellent.
And it's probably still spinning. It's probably still resolving DNS. Once that's finished, we'll actually kind of get back in here to the code. I'm just going to go ahead and scroll down below and add a breakpoint right here. Because what that's going to do is it's going to, once it creates a storage account, then I'm going to basically make a secondary call to it and go out and get the key for the account to build the connection string that I can then use to, you know, upload a file actually using, you know, the blob SDK stuff. Once that is done, I'm going to let that spin for a second. Once that's done, I'm actually going to call this method here, create cloud service. I select this guy and hit F12. I'm just going to expand this code so you can see it. You can see in this case, I'm referencing the compute management client variable that I've got, property that I've got. Again, I'm looking at hosted services. When this finishes running, I'll actually show you that you've got virtual machines, virtual machine disks, virtual machine images, the whole kit and caboodle. I just call create, and then I just pass it a couple of properties again. I want to throw it up in West US. I'm going to give it the cloud service name and also the label here. But you can flip that and reverse it. That's actually going to go out, create an empty cloud service for me. I'll go ahead and put a breakpoint here. So once we get to that part of the code, it'll stop for us. And then the last step that we're going to do, I've got this deploy cloud service guy right here. I want to go to definition real quick. Expand this guy. There we go. So I just actually got my storage account key. The code continued to run. So see, there's our storage account key.
Okay, now I'm going to make use of that later on.
Yeah, today. Sure. So I'm going to step through all this stuff, return the guy, and you'll see now I'm going to upload the package to the blob. Let me get rid of some of my extraneous windows here for you guys. And again, I'm going to go out and I'm going to get the primary key. I just like to do that before every single method call, if at all possible. And I'm going to step through this code. That's going to actually create the container out in the blob and upload the CS package file. And you can see here's the trace running. You can see everything kind of popping up. And now it's going to hand me back that blob URI. If I were to expand that, you see there's our blob storage account with the URI for that service package. And now I've got this create cloud service guy. I'm going to go ahead and just step into this. Now there's our code running. See, it says created storage account. And the next step is already created our hosted service. I'll go out here and hit F5. You should see that a hosted service has indeed been created in this guy. So now we'll have a storage account and a hosted service. There you go. So we already created that stuff. So if I hit F10 here and just kind of step through everything, now what's going to happen is it's going to actually deploy this cloud service. I was getting ready to walk through that code once we kept going. And what I do in this case is actually just get the config XML from that CSEFG file that I've got right here. And I create, you see here that I'm referencing the compute management client one more time. And this time I'm looking at deployments. I'm not looking at hosted services. I want to create a deployment. I want to pass it the name of the service that I want to create. Again, we're giving you some enums here, so that if it's production or staging, you can do all that. The configuration is that XML file that I just read. There's the name and the label for this deployment. I'm going to tell it to go ahead and start the deployment, and the package URI is going to be the URI of that CS package file that lives out of my blob account.
Cool.
Now, this will take a few minutes. We can't make the fabric go faster through the SDK. We can just call the fabric and you know, let it do its thing. What I do want to point out is that all these methods that I'm using today, these are all the synchronous versions of these methods. They're asyncs for all of them as well.
Okay.
So you've got all that functionality. And the last thing that I'll show you, we won't run through this code today, but in this code over here, you'll see that I've created a storage account and uploaded a blob, and then I actually create the cloud service and deploy the cloud service.
Right.
In this case, I'm just going to create the cloud service and then call create virtual machine. And when I do that, if I were to open this method up here, what you're going to see in this code is that I'm going to, I'm going to go out and I'm going to get a list of all the virtual machine images that are out in, you know, Windows Azure. It's a long list.
Yeah.
That's actually a call that you can make. You can see, like, how many Windows images do we have in Azure? You can pick one and party on it. Then I'm going to just, you know, pick the first one that I got. It could be a Ruby image, who knows. I'm just going to grab that image. And then again, I'm going to build, oh, there we go. That code's already run. That service has been deployed. Hit F10 here, and I'll switch back to this code so we can keep discussing it. In this case, I'm going to basically tell it which VHD I want to pull down. And I'm basically just building that, you know, by default, the default blob storage location of the VHDs in Azure. I'm going to new up a parameters guy. And what you'll see that for all of our request and response objects, we're giving you parameter objects and response objects so that we give you a language on the wire. Or in your code so that you don't have to pass lots and lots of gobbledygook parameters. You just pass it a parameters object and you're off and running. We're going to add a role to this. I do want to point out this is just language. This is not a VM role. This is actually a real VM. Corey had to pick on me this morning for that one. I'm just going to add that role to it. And this really just gives a couple different pieces of information. Do I want to read write, read only, which image I want to pull from. It's, you know, the size of the role that I want, and I'm going to add a configuration set on top of it, and this is going to be, you know, the admin username and password for that particular VM once it fires up, the time zone it's in, and all that.
Now we know Brady's password for everything.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. And then we just call create deployment. Again, in this case, we're hanging off the compute management client guy. There's virtual machines. So we've seen hosted services, deployments, virtual machines, and the virtual machine images all hang off that guy. I just call create deployment, I pass it the name, and I pass it those parameters, and that'll actually fire up a brand new VM for us right in the cloud.
Okay.
So you could actually use this guy to do, like I said, pretty much anything you do inside of Windows Azure portal, you could do using this guy, and then probably, and then some if the portal hasn't caught up with the APIs yet.
Great.
So you can breathe now.
Oh, no. I wanted to get through it all.
so that's actually really awesome. So in that short demo, we actually saw creation of a storage account, creating a cloud service, deploying the cloud service. And really, there was not that many lines of code required to do that. So the types of scenarios that I see this being used for is sort of, you know, you're building an enterprise-style application or a SaaS-based solution. And that solution needs to go out and provision resources for those different tenants, perhaps.
Exactly.
This, what are we calling it? The service management library?
Not service management, the Windows Azure Management Libraries.
Windows Azure Management Library?
Service management was the working name.
Okay.
So.
I'll get the names right.
But
so the Windows Azure Management Library essentially makes this incredibly easy to do. Whereas historically, I know it wasn't as full-fledged as it is today.
Right. I mean, the APIs have always been there, and our friend, what was his name, Richard, over in London, he works with Andy Cross. He's actually built something, I think, called Fluent Azure, and he wrapped around the individual, you know, Azure APIs. They're large APIs, so you have to go to MSDN, read the documentation, figure out what the payload looks like, figure out what your response is going to look like, and then you can party on it. It's it's not exactly a walk in the park, and then you also have to do things like you know, parse the XML, new up a HTTP yeah. client, set the headers, you know, all that stuff. We're making all that pretty transparent for you yep. through this SDK. The other thing, the other scenario that I think is pretty good with this is imagine this code, like you have a TFS build, mm. and the last step of the TFS build is to, like, let's say, deploy a website out to Windows Azure because you've got yep. websites and TFS hooked up. What if you don't have that website created yet? Right. What if the only reason you need that website is to, say, run some coded UI tests?
Yep.
You could actually have a unit test that would go out and provision everything, mm-hmm. deploy your code, then run your coded UI tests, then go that extra step and delete that website
and
tear it all down. Mm-hmm. So you could do your entire dev test world yep. up in Windows Azure, whether or not you're running production yep. in Windows Azure. So you could awesome. You could just make sure everything is good with your unit tests.
Yep.
I'm actually kind of curious if this is finished deploying yet. You'll see here that this still says running. That's just it spinning up the cloud service, the web role, and, you know, getting everything going. I'm actually wondering if it's running yet. It may not be. It looks like it might not be done yet. I wanted to click it and hit browse so you could actually see it. But if you go to what is cloud cover, you know, hostedservice.cloudapp.net, mm-hmm. it just says hello world. But it's okay. a pretty mm-hmm. simple little, you know, web role to just right. throw up in there.
So, excellent.
Okay. Yeah, that's what we've been working on. Ship dates. I can tell you that by the time the show comes out, mm-hmm. we will have probably dropped the new mm-hmm. release of the PowerShell commandlets. Right. The PowerShell commandlets are actually going to sit on top of these libraries.
Okay.
So if you download the PowerShell commandlets, you'll get these libraries in their preview state. Okay. Pretty soon, we're going to be releasing these as NuGet packages. Mm-hmm. So you'll be able to just pull these down from NuGet. We're actually using MyGet right now for our nightly builds,
right.
just to get it to people like you who are yep. you know, kind of dog-fooding it to play around. Speaking of mm-hmm. which, you might need to get that
yeah.
from me.
Yeah.
Might need to send that to you. But he's playing with it in some templates he's working on right now.
Yeah.
So we have a couple of other internal partners that are playing with it, and we've been giving okay. out the URL. We have a Windows Azure hackathon tomorrow on campus, and we're probably mm-hmm. going to use it for our project in the hackathon. But we expect that we'll probably get that out in the next 45, 60 days.
So, awesome.
Mm-hmm. Great.
Mm-hmm.
So,
yeah.
Yeah, we think it'll make life a lot easier.
Yes.
Definitely.
Yeah. So between now and when the NuGet is released, where do people find these assemblies?
You would have to get the new PowerShell commandlet
yep.
release, and the assemblies will be part of that.
Okay.
The assemblies will be
excellent.
In there. So you can reference them and yep. kind of learn from the demos that I've given you here. And if you're interested in getting early access or nightly access mm. to just the assemblies, just get in touch with me either yep. on the comments thing below or
comments
just send me an email.
What's your Twitter?
My Twitter is Brady Gaster, all one
okay.
word.
So or you can tweet me. Email if you prefer email.
That's fine. Brady G at Microsoft.
Okay. So. You're pretty active on there. It's surprising you actually get some work done.
That's kind of a slam, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, he's a PM now. They mostly email, right?
Yeah.
So a lot of my day has been summed up by learning what I didn't know about using Git from the developers on our team. Mm-hmm. They're Git wizards.
Mm-hmm.
So I've actually learned some of my bad habits. Oh, there we go.
There you go.
So I can just select this guy right here. I guess I have to click it. Select this guy. Oh, there it is. There it is. I could have just clicked right there, but there you see. Hello
there
world.
There you go.
Excellent.
So we're up and running.
I'm glad we waited to see Hello World.
I was stalling.
Pretty long Hello yeah. World demo.
Yeah, exactly.
But definitely very powerful stuff.
Cool.
So
yeah.
Thanks very much for coming on the show.
Thanks for having me on.
If you could send us the link to where people can download the PowerShell commandlets to get these assemblies
yep.
initially.
I can do that.
We'll put it at the bottom of the show, and okay. once the NuGets are available, we'll add direct links to that.
I can do that, and that'll be the web PI feed. You'll be able to get yep. PowerShell from the web PI feed.
Okay,
so,
great.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
cool.
So it should be the best way.
Okay, well, thanks for coming and watching, and thanks very much, Brady, for coming on and showing us these cool Windows Azure management libraries.
Yeah, awesome.
Well done.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks a lot, guys.
Bye-bye.
Bye.